Our Blue Cross Blue Shield of Maryland Indian sitting lineup. Marquise Grissom will lead it off at center field. Julio Franco, the DH. Jim Tomey at first base. Matt Williams will hit fourth and play third base. David Justice in left field. Manny Ramirez in right field. Tony Fernandez at second base. Sandy Alomar, Jr., the catcher. Omar Vizquel will play shortstop. And we'll tell you about Charles Nagy in just a second. For now, settle back and enjoy as it's another magnificent evening for Orioles baseball right here out of the yard on the O's Television Network. And Jim, obviously, beginning of a series, as we said, against two ball clubs that have established now a rivalry of sorts, two of the best in the American League.
Certainly have. Both teams won 9 out of their last 11 games. And really the only roadblock for the Orioles are the Indians, where they went into Cleveland last weekend and lost 2 out of 3. A year and has been able to do that. But this is a ball club. You elevate the ball, they'll elevate it. They are second in the home run department. We're actually leading the league in home runs, third in runs. They have 3 more home runs in Seattle, and they trail both the Yankees in Seattle in run score.
Mike Mussina facing Marquise Grissom, the center fielder. Cut on and miss. 2-1 now on Grissom. Gentleman that came over with David Justice, as we look at Mike Mussina, off to a brilliant start, Jim. No question about that.
Certainly is, and a very accomplished pitcher, as is Charles Nagy. Nagy winning 17 and 16 his last 2 years, Mike 19. And the one thing that Ray Miller said, when you get a guy that has had great success, and Mike certainly has had that, is that you don't ignore him. So in during spring training, he just said, listen, I looked at the films. We're going to try to keep the ball down. You become a little bit more predictable, maybe throwing too many fastballs. So let's use all your pitches and let's try to keep the ball, especially here in Camden Yards, down. Take advantage of that infield.
Count runs full at 3-2 on Marquise Grissom. Grissom, Julio Franco, and Jim Tomey. We've talked about and established these are the two of the hottest hitting clubs in Major League Baseball. Both the O's and the Indians have been on a roll during the course of the last 10. Indians have won 8 of their last 10 to finally get 5 games over the 500 level. Cut on and missed as Mussina rings up Marquise Grissom to start it, blowing him away on that 3-2 pitch.
Well, Mike Mussina not unhappy to see Kenny Lofton down in Atlanta. Lofton going over to the Atlanta Braves, Justice and Grissom coming over here, but Lofton a little bit different leadoff hitter. And here are the 4 keys to the games. To Charles Nagy, you better keep the ball down because you're a sinker ball pitcher, and you better out pitch Mussina, and that's really what it's about when you get two good hitting teams together.
4 keys to the contest brought to you by your local Ford dealers. Here's Julio Franco now. Julio, the DH. Now, Jim, I was in Cleveland in 1984 working in this business when this young man at 155 pounds came over from the Philadelphia organization as a shortstop, kind of erratic defensively, but my, he has matured into one of the best hitters in baseball.
Well, won a batting title. You know, over a 300 lifetime hitter, uses the whole field. You know, last year hit 14 home runs, but I honestly believe if he thought more about hitting home runs, he could be a guy that could hit 20, 25. Maybe the average would go down. Good number 2 hitter if you're going to use him in that spot, but he can also hit 3 or 4 because of the average capabilities.
And has many times in many places in his career. Fouled right side by Franco. Julio's played a little bit of second base this year, Jim. And of course, we know that the knees have been bad. Julio played second base in Texas after he left the Indians and had great success there until he once again moved down to Chicago and now right back in Cleveland.
Well, he was never known for his glove, Mike.
I know that. Yeah, I understand that.
But
well,
he said he was erratic.
Oh,
yeah. He came to spring training about 10 pounds lighter because they told him, hey, you may be our second baseman. And he said, in talking to him before the game, he said he usually plays second base about maybe 2-3 times a week. Tony Fernandez playing on a more regular basis.
Just underway as we're pleased to have you with us out of the yard on the O's Television Network. Michael Regai and Jim Palmer. As this, Jim, you attach a lot of significance to this. Of course, the Indians won 2 of the 3 last weekend in Jacobs Field. And, you know, as I said, now given the history last year in the ALCS, these two ball clubs seem to be real in tune with one another, knowing why don't we establish that we're a better ball club and maybe a team to beat.
Well, the Indians, and we'll talk more about that, they're a much better team when they did what they do so well, which and we're talking about hitting, but we're talking about pitching. They led the American League in pitching the last 2 years. This year, a little bit different case, but in May, they are playing very well at 15-9, and And the reason is they're scoring a lot of runs, which is something they've done the last couple of years. 2 years ago, they won 100 out of 144. Last year, they won 99. But when they're a truly great club, they're going to also hit, but they're going to pitch. And that's what they've done in May. Now, the Orioles, they're hitting on all cylinders. They're hitting, they're pitching, they're playing great defense. I don't know if there's any significance, but you have the two best teams right now in the American League playing each other.
2-2 to Franco, just got a piece of it. Julio hasn't had a lot of success against Mike Mussina. We see 4 for 19, Jim, and I think you and I have talked about this, but how many times do you say it takes for a hitter pitcher matchup to establish that one guy's got a little bit of an edge over the other one? 30, 40 trips at the plate?
Well, I don't know if you put a quantitative number on it, but I'll tell you what, if you're Mike Mussina and you pay attention, you know that at any moment Julio Franco can just jump up and bite you. He's that good a hitter. And I look at Messina's numbers, 4 for 19. He's making good pitches.
Bouncing ball over the head of Mussina. Bordick will back up on the big hop. Flip out Franco. Mussina has handled Grissom and Franco here at the top of the Indians hitting lineup. Let's take a look at our umpires tonight. The men who make the decisions. Terry Kraft is behind home plate. Chuck Merriweather at first base. Jim Evans and Larry McCoy, a couple of longtime American League veterans, handles second base and third base, respectively. That's a beautiful Friday night. And Jim, great to be back home after a successful road trip by the ball club. You know, Davey Johnson, Mike Flanagan, and I have been talking about. Davey says increments. We're 15 over 500 when we started the trip. I want to be 20 over when we get back. And maybe without the rain out, he would have been 19 over as he always come back home.
Well, if you look where they are, I mean, both the Yankees and Toronto, 9 games back in the loss column. And does that mean you're going to win the pennant? No. Does that mean you're going to, automatically win 90, 92 games? 92 games, won it in the American League East. To me, and if you talk to Davey, he says what we want to do is continue to play well. And the formula this year has been getting outstanding pitching. You know you're going to get hitting. The defense is better.
Jim Thome, speaking of defense, has moved over from one corner to the other for Mike Hargrove and the Indians here in 1997. Thome, it's been a long time fixture at third base, but you go get a Matt Williams, it necessitates a move. Thome did it, playing first base now exclusively. A knuckle curve, didn't miss by much. 2-1 on Jim Thome. 13th round draft selection, not highly thought of when he comes out of high school and junior college. And then, wow, he has exploded under the tutelage of Charlie Manuel and really taken off.
Well, he had him at AAA down in Charlotte, and he said he was like a man among boys, the most valuable player in that league. Had an incredible year. And he's a very disciplined hitter. He strikes out a lot. Struck out 141 times last year. Also walks a lot. Scores a lot of runs. Hit 38 home runs. But he's not afraid, as we've seen right here, to go deep into the count looking for his kind of pitch. I mean, he's a rarity in some respects that he's a young hitter that has a pretty good idea at the plate. And he's not anxious to hit the first pitch he sees. Doesn't mind seeing a number of pitches.
Did he go? McCoy says no down at third base. Counters run full on Jim Thome. Well, you talk about the walks, Jim, and exactly. Last year, he walks 123 times. I mean, Manuel told him, you do that for me, be more patient, I can help you put 25 to 40 points on your hitting average.
And he's gone to be a high average hitter.
Yeah. Payoff pitch to Thome. Called strike three. Mike Mussina rung him up. Thome took one too many strikeouts at Grissom and Thome as Mike Mussina retires the Indians in order in the first. Orioles coming to hit on the O's TV network. We're scoreless. This is how Davey Johnson lines them up on our Blue Cross Blue Shield American Orioles hitting lineup. Brady Anderson will lead off and play center field. Robbie Alomar at second base, hitting second. Rafael Palmeiro in the third spot, first base. Cal Ripken will hit cleanup and play third base. B.J. Surhoff in left field hitting fifth. Peter Gavilla, the DH tonight. Tony Tarasco's in right field. Chris Hoyle's behind the plate hitting eighth. Mike Bordick's at shortstop hitting ninth. And they'll face the former Big East, University of Connecticut Husky, one of the best in the business, Charlie Nagy.
Well, he certainly is. And, he's not overpowering, but you can see he sinks the ball. He's got a splitter, curveball, changeup. And last 2 years, 17 wins, led the Indians last year, tied with Oral Hershiser in 1995 when they went all the way to the last game when they lost 1-0 in the sixth game of the World Series with 16 wins that year.
We'll take a look at Brady Anderson to be followed by Robbie Alomar and Rafael Palmeiro. Last time the Orioles were in activity, these three all with big two-run home run blast in Tiger Stadium. And that one win, of course, Orioles lost it yesterday. I got the sense, Jim, that Davey wanted to send out Mike Mussina against Tim Pugh. And, of course, Buddy Bell wanted it called even sooner to get on that trip to Seattle.
You know, it does change up the way you go about it if you're Nagy. I mean, if you look at the games last weekend in Cleveland, they didn't pitch against each other. Mussina pitches against Steve Kline. He gets sent to the minors the next day because he gives up, a three in the first inning, and he gets a big lead. And then Charles has, a 7-2 lead, and eventually hangs on, throws solo home runs to Surhoff and Palmeiro in the fifth and sixth innings. I don't think you're going to see that type of offense tonight. I may be wrong. But normally when you match up two guys that know what they're doing, and Nagy and Mussina do, you don't have a lot of runs scored even here at Camden Yards.
Although now we saw that final game of that trip in Seattle with Mussina and Randy Johnson, you get the big billing out there, and both of them were hurt by the long ball. And of course, last time too, that on a Monday with Andy Pettitte down the mound, as Brady Anderson lines it in the corner and right. Brady's ticket too. Ramirez throw to second, not in time. Brady Anderson with a two-base hit. For the Birds, that's their 73rd double on the year, and for Brady, that is his 11th.
Batting second, the second baseman.
Well, you can't complain about the batting average. Power's a little bit down because of the rib injury, but right here, 2-2, it looked like Nagy tries to take a little bit off. And Brady is just trying to make contact, plays in front of him, even though Ramirez had 19 assists last year, led all American League outfielders. Brady easily into second with a double. And now Robbie Alomar can do just about whatever. You can bunt him over, you can hit that ground ball, try to get him in with a base hit. And this is what we saw so much last year. Brady get on, Alomar, Chris, with that great start, 79 hits through the first 2 months.
Well, you see the positioning of the Indians defense. We've seen Robbie, as Jim said, in this spot many times this year, trying to move people as he shows bunt, rolls it foul up the left side.
Well, Davey Johnson, when Alomar was so hot last year, I mean, the 79 hits through the month of April and May, Davey actually moved him to the third spot because he didn't like to see him give himself up. You know, normally you got a right-handed hitter hitting second, he'll take a shot to right field, hit the ball the other way, and Davey would like to see a big inning, because how often against an accomplished pitcher like Charles Nagy do you have a chance? He's coming out of the bullpen, maybe doesn't know what his stuff is, different mound, different look, a lot of things going on for him.
Alomar this time will get it toward Jim Thome. Does he have time? No. Infield base hit, bunt base hit for Roberto Alomar as he showed third base side first and then got Thome in no man's land.
Well, Thome, as you mentioned, moving across the diamond from third to first, and you know, that's a play you work on all spring. But the way this is successful defensively, as you look at the bunt from Robbie Alomar, is that you got to communicate right away. Thome doesn't come and get it in a hurry. By the time he makes up his mind, Nagy can't get it. It doesn't give Fernandez, the second baseman, a chance to cover and get to first base. So you have a first and third situation for a guy that's been hitting the ball pretty good, four home runs in his last seven games. The sleeping giant has awoken.
Yes, he has. He had a blistering road trip. Rafi with a three home runs and seven RBI and hit 360 through Cleveland, New York City, and the one in Detroit. Runners at the corners here early on against Charles Nagy is Anderson with his double and Robbie Alomar with a bunt base hit.
Well, great hitting situation, other than Nagy knows what he's doing on the mound. First base hole. And Thome is holding him on. Charles Nagy says, this is the last thing I wanted to have happen. But again, if you're an accomplished pitcher, and Charles is, you try to stay away from the big inning. I mean, but when I was in this situation, I'd just say, here, have your run. Mm-hmm. And didn't want to give it up.
Mm-hmm. 1-1 to Palmeiro, line to right, coming hard. Ramirez going to play it on one hop, base hit. Anderson had to wait and see, but he'll touch in on the RBI base hit off the bat of Rafael Palmeiro. Now, Rafi The third consecutive hit now off Charles Nagy puts the Orioles on the board quickly against one of the best in the American League and 1-0.
Well, it appeared to me another changeup that Rafael just, again, when you're zoned in, he just is maybe out of front a little bit, but waits just long enough, sinks it in front of the right fielder, Manny Ramirez, and here comes Brady. 1-0. And if you're Nagy, you don't know if you have good stuff or not. Brady hit a changeup for a double. Palmeiro hit the changeup for a single, and you have not been able to establish your best pitch, which is a sinker.
There's Cal Ripken now. Very significant day if you weren't with us at the top of the show a few moments ago. Cal Ripken on this day 15 years ago. Jim Palmer was in an Oriole uniform on that night. Some say he was throwing. Yeah. My partner can't remember
82,
if he was or wasn't.
82, I might have been pitching. 84, I was definitely throwing.
Cal on a high hop off the plate. Nagy's only got one place to go, and that's to Jim Thome. So Cal actually did his job as he moved up Alomar and Palmeiro into scoring position on the bouncing ball, the comebacker, back to Charles Nagy.
Well, Cal's not happy because he went after a pitcher pitch. You know, if you're Rick Down, the hitting instructor, and you talk about Charles Nagy, what you say is, you know, contrasting to Randy Johnson, who you want to make the ball be down, you say, make this guy get the ball up. But as you mentioned, you do move the runners into scoring position, and they're going to walk Surhoff. I never liked this, but this is the percentage play.
With Incaviglia coming up.
Because if Incaviglia hits it on the ground, and again, if you're Jeff Newman or if you're Mike Hargrove, who's not here tonight, attending the graduation of his daughter, this is the percentage play. Get out of the inning with one pitch. If Nagy's able to make the quality pitch that he normally can make. Otherwise, it could be 5-0.
So Surhoff will take the free pass, and that's going to get Pete Incaviglia a look with the bases loaded and one out here in the Orioles half of the first at Charles Nagy. Incaviglia 2-for-7 against Nagy career-wise without a home run or RBI. So again, we talked about the not many square-offs between these two.
Now, this would not be the ideal matchup that you want if you were Davey Johnson. You would usually, you know, Eric Davis would be playing. Mm-hmm. Eric out with a stomach problem. But Incaviglia, you know, had a great series up in New York, some key hits, but they were mostly off lefties. And it's his job right now. The pressure is on Charles Nagy. Try to get a good pitch to hit. Balls he was able to hit in New York were balls out over the plate, which is where his strength is. Try to get a ball you can elevate. Fly ball will probably score another run.
Nagy got the breaking pitch in there to level the count at 1-1 on Incaviglia. Pete at 287 on the year, and if you were with us Memorial Day in Yankee Stadium, had a tremendous afternoon. Massey without Eric Davis, as Jim said, now in that BH spot. Nagy again went to the breaking pitch. Pete couldn't find it. He's in a hole at 1-2.
Well, of all the pitchers in the American League, there's only one guy that throws more ground balls, and that's Scott Erickson. He throws it about 75% of the time. Charles Nagy right behind him, 70% of the time. Hershiser right behind him, 67. So he lives by throwing ground balls.
1-2 to Incaviglia, cut on and miss. So Charles Nagy got exactly, with the exception of the double play ground ball, he got exactly what he wanted there to now face Tarasco, but with two out and the bases staying loaded.
So the matchup, you know, the gamble that you take is loading up the bases, but you don't get the double play, but you do get the strikeout through three great breaking balls. Slider and two curve balls down in the strike zone, just a little bit out of the strike zone.
Nagy will face Tony Tarasco now. Tony getting the start in right field against the right-hander Nagy. He and Jeffrey Hammonds have been pretty much in the straight platoon arrangement now that Eric Davis has been shelved and could be shelved for a substantial amount of time. And Tony's delivered some key base hits for the ball club.
Certainly has. His number's only 1-for-5 off of Nagy, and Jeffrey hitting .417. But Davey Johnson saying, listen, I'm going to give these two guys, as you mentioned, equal playing time, at least if the matchup is right. And there's Jeffrey. Big three-run home run up in New York. A monster blow.
Jimmy smoked it. Oh, Monument Park was visited.
I was observing from afar, but I could hear the ring of the bat. That's one thing I still can't forget, the ring of the bat.
Carrasco will drill it foul. Had John Stern skipping rope down there in that Orioles first base coaching box. Yeah, when you visit Monument Park now, I mean, when you started your major league career, the monuments were in play in dead center field.
And I heard Mike Flanagan wrong too often, but it was actually 461 feet
461.
To the monuments. I saw Pepitone my first year in baseball hit a triple. Longest ball hit that year was not even a home run. Kind of bounced around in the monuments, and you know, he had the flagpole and the monuments.
Must have been a slow night before for Joe that he's able to leg out a three base hit.
Joe was known to have some slow nights.
Bases full of Orioles, 2-1 to Tarasco. That fastball on the inside edge. Tony didn't think so.
Well, made the perfect pitch. And that's why he won 17 last year, started the All-Star game. Third lowest earned run average in the American League last year after Pat Henkin, who finished second and won a Cy Young Award, and Juan Guzman, also of the Toronto Blue Jays. So this guy knows what he's doing.
Line drive down the line and left, but it's going to fade foul. Tarasco making a bid the other way. Tony trying to add to this Oriole lead. Just joining us, Bird's got one real quickly. Three consecutive base hits, the Anderson double, bunt base hit from Robbie Alomar, and Rafael Palmeiro's 37th RBI of the year for Dave Johnson's offense. Jeff Newman and Mark Wiley, left and right of your screen. Newman, the acting manager tonight in the absence of Mike Hargrove. Called strike three. Charles Nagy just came back hard and punched out Tony Tarasco. The Orioles strand three to end the first. Birds get one. We'll go to the second. 1-0 on the O's TV network. Cal Ripken being acknowledged and, of course, loved and appreciated here in his home state of Maryland. Cal, on this night, in 1982, 15 years ago, began this marvelous run that has now reached 2,366 consecutive. I asked Jim Palmer about, did you ever have any idea that this young man could come up? And, Jim, you know, it's just, it's incredible. I know everything has been said that can be said about it, but when you think about how you just, as a professional athlete, are going to come to the ballpark not feeling well a lot of times, and this man's played through it all.
Oh, he certainly has. And, you know, I saw him. He used to come and work out when he was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
It reminds me very much of Alex Rodriguez because he got big and strong and got a lot more bat speed in a hurry. And talking about bat speed, Matt Williams will lead it off for the Indians.
I know you were watching last week, but Mike Flanagan and I were talking about in seeing him and David Justice now in this league and getting a chance to view them over here. You know they're terrific players, but the professionalism that they bring to this Indians team and to this clubhouse, remarkable.
Well, it is, and, you know, I've had a chance when I was doing ABC baseball to, you know, do National League, American League games, and I never heard anybody say anything derogatory about Matt Williams.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, he's a wonderful player. He's won three gold gloves. In 94, he was on a Maris-type record, hitting over 40 home runs in about 114 games.
Mussina just busted Matt Williams back, threw him out on the comebackers. So Mike Mussina has retired four in succession here to start the contest. Tonight's Giant HTS Orioles Million Dollar Magic contestant is Brian Bochum from Baltimore. Brian, you've automatically won a Panasonic 27-inch stereo TV. And if an Orioles player hits for the cycle, Brian, you're going to win $1 million. Turn your field of dreams into a field of green by playing Giant HTS Orioles Million Dollar Magic and see your local Giant for details. Brian, good luck to you. We'll root for you up here as you do at home. Now here's the man that came over from Atlanta, and David Justice, 15 home runs, 41 RBI, but Jim, 391. Now he's flirting with the same thing Robbie. Yeah, Robbie was above 400 entering June. He's going to be probably very close to it in the next couple of days. And he just ate Oriole pitching up last weekend in Jacobs Field.
What was he, 7-for-9 with three doubles and a home run?
Mike Flanagan said he was 10-for-9.
Yeah, I know. I heard that.
Did you?
Well, it seems that way. And when a guy is hitting 391, I just figured he's probably going to get a base hit. So where do you want the base hit? You better make good pitches. And I mean, you know, you pitch to an area where you think you're going to be able to keep the ball in the park. You try to keep David Justice from coming up with runners on scoring position, and just little things like that, they're going to help you win. And you want to stay ahead of them so you can really just kind of not pitch defensively. And that doesn't always work. And you guys were talking last weekend. I mean, one of the great streak hitters that I saw were Reggie Jackson, Tony Oliva, Don Baylor come to mind. 15 for 20, things like that, and you just can't get them out. What you try to do is keep them in the ballpark. And with Justice, it's been kind of difficult. I said, you know, you really have had a tough time coming over here and adjusting to the American League, haven't you?
That's right.
We just kind of laughed.
Yeah. It's supposed to be an adjustment period. Oh, yeah, you come over here, you haven't seen this pitching before, and then he just tears it up. He awaits the 3-1 from Mike Mussina. Might get about here. Roll to the glove of Robbie Alomar. Mussina with some answers as he gets David Justice to roll over and ground out to Alomar.
Well, he threw him a 3-1 changeup. And David Justice, they said, how long will this streak, you know, stay in effect? He said, until I lose patience. And maybe that's one of those situations. Figured he'd get a good pitch. A mere mortal would throw him a 3-1 fastball, but Mussina doesn't operate that way. Threw him a great pitch. Got the out.
Here's another young man that was absolutely on fire last weekend in Cleveland, much to the dismay of you O's fans and the O's pitching staff, Manny Ramirez. Ramirez, 7 home runs and 30 RBI, and he has had 4 base hits off Mike Mussina and their get-togethers in his young career.
Just turned 25.
Had some big power numbers early, certainly at Jacobs Field, and last couple years hitting behind Baerga, Bell, Murray, Tomey. And now he hits behind Tomey, Williams, and Justice. So still pretty good company that Manny Ramirez follows in this Indians hitting lineup. 2-1 on Manny. Young man out of the Bronx, New York. Jim, a lot of power to all fields.
Oh, yeah.
You've got to guard all the exits against this guy. He'll take pitches off that outside corner and drive him 400 feet to dead right field.
Well, they tell that story. One of the scouts for the Indians went in with John Hart, and they saw this kid, obviously, driving across the parking lot, taking batting practice. And the kid said, if I ever see anybody that reminds me of Roberto Clemente, I'm going to sign him. I'm going to make sure I sign him. And they signed him. 19 assists. You know, occasionally at 25, still doesn't run hard. Matter of fact, in spring training, Hargrove took him out of a ball game. This is before Mike Hargrove, who's not here tonight because of the graduation of his daughter, hadn't gotten that extension. We'll talk about it a little bit later, but John Hart said, I need to have more discipline. He didn't run out of ball, hooked him. And that's the way you sometimes teach young players lessons.
Bouncing ball to the right of Bordick. He'll brace on the outfield grass, and Manny Ramirez only about a third of the way down the line. So Bordick was able to take his time, set, and throw out Ramirez. That's going to do it for the Indians in the second. Mike Mussina has retired 6 in a row. 1-0 Birds on the Orioles Television Network. O's fans, want to remind you the inaugural Interleague Play Series here at the Yard is scheduled for June 16, 17, and 18 when the O's battle the Montreal Expos. You don't want to miss out on this opportunity to see the long-awaited event in baseball history. Get your tickets right now at the O's box office, any Ticketmaster, or the numbers you see on your screen can be reached also. Orioles baseball, just nothing like a day right here at the Yard.
Yeah, you might not recognize too many of the names from Montreal, other than Pedro Martinez, Felipe Alou, but I mean,
yeah,
he's got him over 500 again.
Yep. It's amazing.
Small market team. Unbelievable.
Chris Hoyle is going to face Charles Nagy here to start off the Orioles half of the second. Orioles loaded the bases, pushed one across, and then Nagy got tough. He struck out Incavilla and Tarasco to leave 3 stranded.
Yeah, 2 big strikeouts, and if Chris Hoyles has the kind of night he had in batting practice, he's going to go about 3 for 5 with about 3, at least 3 home runs. And I know that's only batting practice, but boy, was he on.
Where I was going to go to you is, how many times, though, did you come out of the bullpen and say, I've got nothing, I don't feel well, and then go out and throw a 2-hit shutout and strike out 10?
Depends really how many line drives were hit at people that night. Another big night for the Orioles tonight. The pitchers hit. Mm-hmm. They're out there early. Mm-hmm. Nothing really to report.
You didn't see anything that really stood out to you, huh?
No, Randy Myers said, boy, you know, I used to be able to hit. I said, come on. I said, how many at-bats did you have a year? He said one or two. I said, how could anybody tell? But they were out there. Everybody had double batting gloves. Scott Erickson said, I had a home run. I said, I had 59 one year off Billy Hunter. Big
yeah,
deal.
That's right.
Davey Johnson said, I think I'm going to play it very conservatively. Mm-hmm. We're going to bunt a lot.
Understood.
That's right.
Understood.
Nobody hurt. That's what Davey said. You know, every time my pitchers would hit, even in the National League, it seems like somebody had hit a ball off their foot or whatever. But Jimmy Key did have the best stroke.
Did he?
Mike Johnson actually hits from the left side. Didn't know that. Not a switch hitter. Just throws right-handed, hits left-handed.
Orioles held up. Count runs full as Nagy works to the Birds catcher. Chris still very consistent, very solid. 290 on the year with his 7 home runs and 23 RBI. Been above 300 for most of the year. Payoff pitch to Hoyles. He'll get another chance as he fouls it over that Indian dugout.
Well, he's getting respect. Charles Nagy, he looked at the numbers. Threw him a little splitter. Chris, not the type of guy when he's hitting well that you just lay in the fastball in there. And pitch him appropriately.
Bounce to the glove of Tony Fernandez at second base. He'll toss out Chris Hoyle. So after Nagy loaded the bases in the first and gave up one, he has now retired three in a row. And as we said, the big strikeouts of Incavilla and Tarasco. That's a glorious Friday night for baseball. Start of a big weekend. Jim and walking around the Inner Harbor area today. And saw a lot of... Of course, you're going to see all the Orioles colors, but a lot of Cleveland Indian fans have made their way into downtown Baltimore for this big weekend series.
Well, they can't get a seat.
That's right.
At the Jake, right?
That's
right. They sold out for the year again.
Yes, again, second straight year. And Mike Bordick.
Yeah, not that it's easy to get a seat down
no.
here at Camden Yards
no,
either.
You're right. Hey, Bordick's had a very good living against Charles Nagy. He's hit the baseball very well against Nagy in their matchups. Mike at 400. 14 for 35. Couple RBI. Chuck Merriweather.
Well, if you've been watching this game, you get the idea of why Nagy is a pretty good pitcher. I mean, he'll throw his breaking ball anytime. He can keep the ball down. And he's hoping that that first inning, an inning where he only gave up one run, is his bad inning tonight. You know, Mike Bordick getting a little bit hot. Average over 200, highest it's been at 207. Rick Down still will tell you he's going to hit closer to 300 than he is to 250.
Breaking pitch and sharply, but straight to the glove of his opposite number, Omar Vizquel. He will throw out Bordick. It's a treat when you watch that man right there handle the glove. Jim, we were talking about this last weekend. Him at shortstop, and of course Bordick, one of the best in the game, and Robbie Alomar at second base. When they all get on the diamond against one another, it's like you know, who can outdo the other one? And Alomar last weekend in Cleveland, wow.
Well, Vizquel, I mean, he's a highlight film, and then the guy right to his right, our left, has won three Gold Gloves, and that's Matt Williams. Davey Nelson, coach for the Indians, talking about how well Williams has played at third base, how smooth he is. Reminded him very much of Buddy Bell. Bell, I think, won about 6-7 Gold Gloves. So don't hit it to the left side of the Indians infield. You got to mess around with Fernandez and Tomei if you can.
Mm-hmm. Here's Brady. Brady had the two base hit in the corner and right his first time off Charles Nagy and touched in on the Rafael Palmeiro base hit. That's where we stand right now. Palmeiro's 37th RBI of the year is giving the O's a quick 1-0 advantage. Jim, Brady's power stroke started to come back in about the last 10 days. He really impressed going the other way in Tiger Stadium out over that 400-foot mark in deep left center field off Brian Moeller on Wednesday night. called strike three. Charles Nagy has now struck out three as Anderson took a look at one too many. Let's go to the third here in the yard. 1-0 Birds on the Orioles Television Network.
Everybody's ready, so here we go.
Now this is how it looked at 1982 when Cal Ripken first played third base.
Ground ball, choppy hit to third baseman Ripken. He's up with it nicely. The throw to first, and that takes care of it. Sensei in California.
1982.
So what do you think, Jim? 15 years doesn't look too much different?
Well, he looks a couple of years older. Just imagine if he had played that close to home plate all those years. I don't know if he's fairly great. Play all those games, you can understand that. But playing that close, probably have a lot more wrinkles, concern.
Well, we saw him take that tumble over the photographer's row in Yankee Stadium the other night. Of course, it needed the stitches to close things up. This is Tony Fernandez facing Mike Mussina to start out. Tony with that swinging bunt that we saw Omar Vizquel perfect last weekend in Cleveland with his base hit down the line and left. Tony Manuel teaching this now? He must be. Manuel, of course, is the hitting coach of the Indians. We talked about Julio Franco playing some second base. This guy, this veteran of many a major league war, has pretty much solidified the spot now. And he has just been rung up. He was frozen as Mike Mussina dropped that breaking pitch on the inside edge for Mussina. That is his third strikeout.
Oh, two strikes, you're trying to protect the plate. But this, I mean, this is such a good tight spin on this knuckle curveball that Tony doesn't read the pitch, can't even get the bat off his shoulder. I mean, you're looking for the ball with two strikes. You're not guessing for any specific pitch. He couldn't even get it off his shoulders at all. Couldn't get it started.
Here's Sandy Alomar now, Robbie's brother, the catcher of the Indians. Sandy has been hot pretty much all year long. You see the power numbers there. Sandy, that's what he usually does on the year, and he's off in double figures home run wise already.
And most he's ever hit is 14. Offseason training program. Bigger, stronger, and the Indians and Sandy hope he'll be healthier. Well, you go through the press guide and talk about how difficult it is to catch and how it wears on your body. But I mean, you can go from year to year, and there's almost always, I mean, especially with my yellow markers, some injury. Goodbye.
Sandy did not have a good hack at that as Mike Mussina fooled him down and away. That is number four on the strikeout side as Mussina and Nagy are starting to ring up the K's here early.
Well, another breaking ball, another knuckle curve. Bottom falls right out of it. I mean, the difference between a good curveball and a bad one is the spin. How tight is it? Tighter it is, harder it is to pick up. And if you don't see it, hard to lay off it.
There's a slick fielding shortstop that we saw a moment ago. Flashes glove to the Orioles offense, Omar Vizquel. Omar hitting in that number nine spot. In the last couple of years, he's been all over Mike Hargrove's lineup. He's hit behind Kenny Lofton a little bit in that two spot. Down at the nine spot also. Tough out though, Mike. Jim, it looks like, you know, he's at 251, but a guy that always puts a ball in play, and once in a while, you know, from middle of the plate in, he'll fool you and turn on it and drive that right field line.
Well, hit more home runs last year. In fact, had his best offensive year.
Lined here to the glove of B.J. Surhoff. B.J. crossing that line, made the grab in fair territory, so that's going to do it. Mike Mussina is in cruise control right now. Nine up and nine down through that Indian lineup. 1-0 Orioles when we come back to the yard. All right, those fans, here's a question for you. Are you looking for your best deal on a new or used car? You got to go to Mr. Nobody's Town & Country Pontiac Nissan Suzuki. It's on Bel Air Road in Perry Hall. Now, if it's not a Town & Country deal, it's just simply not your best deal. And say hello to Jim's good buddy, Mr. Nobody, when you head over there. How's he been?
Oh, I played golf with him the other day.
Yeah? Okay.
Just a quick 9, 10, 11 holes.
You didn't do what Michael Jordan did on his off day. Did? How'd you like
How
that?
How about Ahmad Rashad? I mean, you know, he's a reporter, a journalist. He was with him and reported he played 18 holes when he played, what, 46?
46. Yeah.
What's that do for your credibility?
Jim, no, let's not get started on that right now.
No, seriously.
I understand what you're saying.
Well, maybe Ahmad was bad at math.
Maybe that could be. You want to give him the benefit of the doubt?
I guess.
Okay.
NBC is.
Here's Robbie. Robbie with a shot off the glove of Charlie Nagy to the glove of Tony Fernandez. Not in time. Well, Fernandez kind of nonchalantly one motion flipped that. Never got to Jim Thome, who looked like he was hung out to dry. We'll wait and see. And with the baseball going in the Orioles dugout, Robbie also is going to get awarded second base.
First baseman, Rafael
Maryland. Well, you know, they talk so much about being a good infielder, you have to have fast feet. Now, I don't think he ever gets his feet set. He chooses not to set his feet, does the flip throw he used to do from shortstop, but at shortstop, you're going towards first. This time you're going away. Thome, inexperienced at first, doesn't come up with a hop. I think Robbie would have beat it anyway.
Yeah, it scored a base hit and then the throwing error on Fernandez to allow Alomar to go to second. That's the fourth Oriole base hit. They've come from the top three men in the hitting lineup. There's a man that delivered the RBI. As you see, Rafi just absolutely ablaze with the bat of late as he's really kicked it back into gear.
Let's see if he can get Robbie either in or over. Something about Nagy, he is using both sides of the plate. Gets you reaching for that breaking ball, and as he did to Tarasco when he got the big strikeout to end the first, buzzes you on the inside part of the plate. A little bit on, a little bit off. A little bit in, a little bit away.
Bouncing ball, right side, came up. Thome gloved it. So as Jim just mentioned, the job done by Rafael Palmeiro as he pushes Roberto Alomar over to third now in scoring position with only one out. Although your esteemed former manager, number four, used to, he didn't like you just giving yourself up.
Well, I don't think Rafael tried to give himself up. I think his intentions was to drive the ball, which he did, but hit it to the right side. You start swinging at that low and away sinker, hitting it at shortstop, even Earl Weaver would have come off the bench. But that's a quality at bat. I mean, that's doing what you need to do to make it easier for Cal. Infield is going to be in. Fly ball will score a run. Sharp hit ball may get through the infield.
Ripken looks at a called strike. Now, this was in the top of the second inning here at the yard when Cal Ripken acknowledged the sold-out crowd as they, as we said, sending him all of their appreciation for 2,366 as it stands tonight in succession. The reigning Iron Man in Major League Baseball. Infield in. Ripken with a bouncing ball that's deflected to Allen to Vizquel. This throw to the plate, not in time. Robbie Alomar will slide in safely. Now, Nagy got a piece of it, deflected right to Vizquel. His throw to the plate, high and wide. Sandy Alomar came out in front of the plate to make the play, and it allowed Roberto to slide in safely.
Well, Nagy unable to come up with it. He hadn't yet to make an error. Vizquel, who came off shoulder surgery, had rotator cuff surgery in October, and missed most of spring training, unable to make a good throw. I'm not sure he would have gotten Roberto, and then Sandy saying, well, maybe I'll have a shot at first, and that wasn't the case either. So 2-0. Orioles now ahead by two over the Nagy.
Now, Cal's going to get credit for an RBI on that fielder's choice bouncing ball of his to give the O's the 2-0 lead. And the error from Fernandez, the throwing error, has come back to haunt the Indians and Charlie Nagy. And BJ now, Surhoff his first time through the intentional pass from Nagy as they chose to deal with Pete Gavilla instead with the base loaded, and it worked for Charles Nagy and the Indians as he struck out in Cavillion Tarasco to end the first.
But as we told you earlier, BJ with a home run off Charles last Sunday. So he knows BJ's capabilities. Got a ball up. And he launched it. Hit it deep to right field at Jacobs Field in Cleveland.
T turned him loose, 3-0, driven to deep center field. Grissom to the track, looking up, going to pull it in at the base of that wall. BJ got turned loose, 3-0. He didn't get cheated as he drilled it about 400 feet to dead center. Marquise Grissom got back there and pulled it in.
Well, any other part of the ballpark, another home run for BJ would have been number 7. But part of pitching well is to try to pitch to the big part of the ballpark. So even 3-0. Nagy gets the ball down and away. Surhoff hits it straight away center. And then Grissom, who's won 4 gold gloves, runs it down.
Cal still at first for Pete Incaviglia now. Pete, as we said, the strikeout victim his first time. Had a big day in Yankee Stadium, 4 RBI, all coming on the 3 base hits, singles that he put together off Yankee pitching. 2-0 to Inky.
Well, let's see right here, fastball hitter. See if he gets the fastball to hit.
Davey's going to do it 2 times in a row, turn a hitter loose, 3-0.
Why not? I mean, he already saw when Nagy works on him what can happen. I mean, he made 3 quality pitches with breaking balls last time to strike him out. This may be the best pitch he gets to hit.
Did turn him loose. Pete couldn't catch up to it, but had quite a hack. Nagy fastball registering 90 miles an hour. So Jim, as you said, not overpowering. He just knows how to pitch.
But good movement. And Terry Kraft, the strikeout to Tarasco, maybe about 2-3 inches off the plate. Terry seems to favor the low strike. And Caviglia thought that ball was below the knees.
After being down 3-0, Charles Nagy has now run the string out. 3-2 pitch to Incaviglia, got him again. Breaking pitch, a slider that stayed up. Pete went through it. O's are done without any further damage here in the bottom of the third. Orioles get one. The lead is 2-0 now on the O's TV network. We're going to the fourth along with Jim Palmer. I'm Michael Reggie. I hope you're enjoying tonight on the O's TV network. Mike Mussina has been just about perfect as he going to retire Marquise Grissom here on the comebacker. That is 10 in succession that Mike Mussina has retired here of this Cleveland hitting lineup.
Designated hitter, Julio Franco.
It'll be interesting to see Mike Mussina when he gets a bat in his hand. You talk about success. I mean, he can throw 3-4 pitches for strikes. He can pitch in and out. Doesn't walk anybody. Striking out almost 8 per 9 innings. He won a gold glove. Can't run on them. They've only attempted to steal 1 time and been unsuccessful. Could kick field goals, could play basketball. Let's see if he can hit.
Mm-hmm. Well, as you bring that up, as we look at Mike Mussina, we're online tonight. We're in cyberspace, America Online, at keyword HTS. So you can get in conversation with Jim Palmer and yours truly. We'll talk baseball with you if you like. Interleague play is looming right around the corner. Julio Franco lines it foul on the right field line. Jim, a question we have online tonight. How do the players feel about interleague play? Are they for it? They against it? They just going to take it, wait and see attitude? What sense do you get?
I think they're realists. I think, this is a very focused ball club. And reality is that they may be at a disadvantage going to the National League parks where the pitcher has to hit.
Mm-hmm.
They did it a little bit in spring training, but it didn't count. And they're going to have to play 2 of the better teams in the National League, and that's the Florida Marlins and Atlanta Braves in their own ballpark. But if you're the Orioles and you have World Series aspirations, to me, I don't really like it, because I've always liked the sanctity of who's better, the American League and National League, and let's see in October. But pretty good barometer, because you may be playing in Florida or Atlanta in October. At least that's the goal.
Cut on and miss. Mike Mussina just threw it right by Julio Franco for Mussina on the evening. That is strikeout number 5 and 11 in succession.
Now, I don't think that extra day has hurt him.
No.
I mean, he's got such great command of everything. Hadn't used a changeup too much, but it set up this high fastball by getting the knuckle curveball over, occasional changeup as he threw to David Justice. And don't think that Cleveland hasn't got the message. We don't want to get to two strikes. His stuff is so good tonight. So let's try to put the ball in play early in the count. And they've been unable to do it. He's just got such good velocity and movement on his fastball and location. Then when he looked fastball, he just drops the knuckle curveball over.
As he just did to Jim Thomey. Thomey, the first baseman, strikeout victim, called third his first time. Jimmy has unloaded 9 of his 10 home runs, as you see, against right-handed pitching this year. Didn't want to, tapped it right back to Mussina. Two gone quickly, and that's the end of it here in the Indians' third. He's retired him so quick, Jim. I'm missing one. Looking at Mussina go to work. Still 2-0 Orioles on the O's TV network. Back inside Camden Yards on the Orioles Television Network. Nissan Trivia Time. Who's the last Indian to lead the club in home runs other than Albert Bell? And Bell had the amazing run with the power numbers in Cleveland. So we'll let you chew on that for a couple outs or so, and then we'll visit it and see if you came up with the right answer. Jim, you think you have it?
No.
No. Okay. Well, we'll
Boog Bell.
In the tomato red uniform that he used to wear.
That's
with
right.
Frank Robinson, right?
The big boy.
And as we're on the O's Television Network tonight, Debbie Stone from WJZ TV, an anchor here in Orioles country, in the city of Baltimore, of course, enjoying herself at the yard tonight as Tony Tarasco has another opportunity to get squared away with Charles Nagy. Tony struck out with the bases loaded to end the Oriole first. Second time he'll face Nagy. 2-0 Birds as we're moving right along here now in the bottom of the fourth. Popped him up, going to reach the seats. Williams will take a look, and Tarasco in a hole at 0-2.
Well, what Nagy does is really what Mark Wiley, who used to be a pitching coach here in the Baltimore Oriole organization, espouses, and Ray Miller, who came over, is to use all your pitches, change speed, stay out of the middle of the plate, pitch quickly. You don't get a whole lot of pitches to drive off of Charlie. I mean, he always has you reaching, or he always has you out in front, or you're hitting the top of the ball. And you saw those numbers on Tony Tarasco. Still trying to stay from rolling over, a term you use a lot. Davey Johnson said, you know, the whole league knows he's a high ball hitter, so what they try to do, take a little bit off, throw the breaking ball, and ball's not up, he doesn't really have a lot of success.
1-2 on Tarasco. Jim, when you first saw Charles Nagy come up, I mean, he begins in 1992, really, with the Indians, comes on the scene, wins 17 games. Did you think he'd develop into this type of such an efficient pitcher as he has?
Well, you knew he had good stuff and a pretty good idea, but then he had the shoulder surgery,
yeah.
And what, to go 2-6 a couple of years later.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people didn't know if he'd ever come back, but as we mentioned, 16 wins 2 years ago, 17 last year, 17-5, third best earned run average, and then quite a thrill. Saw him up in Philadelphia as he started the All-Star game.
3-2 on Tony Tarasco. Tony in right field again tonight. Of course, Eric Davis, Jim touched on it a little bit earlier. If you're just joining us, he's still undergoing a lot of tests here by the Orioles medical staff. And Tony is almost like gastrointestinal problems, or Eric rather, that is keeping him out of the lineup, as Tarasco again just got rung up by Charles Nagy. So he has struck out Incaviglia and Tarasco 6-7 in Davey Johnson's hitting lineup 4 times, 2 apiece.
Well, first time fastball nipped the inside corner, this time breaking ball, spread it out over the outside part of the plate, bring it in, and Tony gives up on it. Ball breaks and catches the outside corner.
Here's catcher Chris Hoyles. Chris bounced out to Tony Fernandez his first time.
Well, we certainly hope that Eric's is all right. You hope it's nothing serious. You know, quality guy. I know he's going to do some clinics here in the Baltimore area. I mean, so good for this ball club.
Sharply off the bat of Hoyles to the glove of Matt Williams, who threw across to Jim Thomey to retire Chris.
And not just because of his performance. I mean, you know, even when he was hurt with a hamstring, a couple of the other injuries, the bruised left shoulder, You know, the type of guy you have, you want in the clubhouse. Davey Johnson knows that. That's why he had Pat Gilly go out and get him. And a guy that can beat you so many different ways. So we wish him well. Hope he's back in a hurry.
Now, Eric's been a tremendous influence, as you said, and also he's put the numbers up, too, through 2 months with his 7 home runs and driven in some key runs for the Orioles.
Well, he's a perfect veteran player because he plays hard. You know, he runs balls out. I mean, he just does all the little things that are important when you have young players on your team. And you have fans in the ballpark that want to see players hustle.
Well, as we've worked together, the two of us, too, this year, I know he's made gone to the gap in right center field and to the line in right field. And you're a large admirer of his work defensively, given what, as you brought up a few times, what has happened to Oriole pitching staff in the last year or so with that situation in right field.
Well, this staff, they've given up what almost 3.55 runs a game. Last year gave up over 5 in defense. I played on some great defensive ball club that makes it a lot easier, gets you in a positive mode. You're not afraid of the consequences once they hit the ball. And that's what Ray Miller said. I'm going to come over here, very much what Charles Nagy has done. Make him hit the ball, put it in play.
2-2 to Mike Bordick, drilled over the head of Nagy to center field, base hit. Mike Bordick, as we mentioned, his first time to the plate. Again, above the 400 mark against Charlie Nagy. Now 15 for 37 career-wise against Nagy.
Oh, got a good pitch back to both the bats. Hit a ball hard at Vizquel the first time. This time looked like it's just a sinker that stays up. And you can see Mike getting a ball he can handle. And talking to Davey Johnson, manager of the Orioles, before the game, I said, doesn't Bordick remind you of a player you had in New York, Wally Backman, where you don't want him hitting fly balls? He said, exactly, because his fly balls usually get caught. Line drives and ground balls. That should be Mike Bordick.
Give Brady a chance now with 2 out here in the Orioles half of the 4. Brady started things out against Charlie Nagy by doubling down the line and right. Eventually came around a touch in on Rafael Palmeiro's RBI base hit.
And that's an important base hit because Charles Nagy knows you're one pitch away from a 2-run home run if you don't make a good pitch.
Bounce to the glove of Omar Vizquel. That'll get Charlie Nagy out of the 4th. Anderson bouncing out to short. Orioles strand 1. Let's go to the 5th. 2-0 Birds on the Orioles TV network. Back inside Camden Yards, let's take a look at what's coming up as we swing around our Hoover upcoming contest for you. It'll be HTS on Monday night. Matt Williams and the Indians still in town against the Orioles. 7:30, we'll start it with those report at 7 o'clock. And then the New York Yankees come in. It's the rematch of the 2-game set in the Bronx from earlier this week. And we'll see you on O's TV on Tuesday night and then back on HTS with those report at 7 o'clock before Bernie Williams comes into town to take on the Orioles. Here we're going to the top of the 5th. Mike Mussina has been letter perfect, retiring all 12 that he's faced. Matt Williams making a bid to end that with that shot just outside the bag and foul starting out the 5th. But Jim, we talk about Mike Mussina, and you know, quite ironically here tonight, he's dominating this ball club. He beat the Indians last week, but in his career, Mike just 3-6 in 10 starts. Indians, one of the teams that always have given him trouble.
Well, they're also one of the quality teams in baseball over the last 3 to 4 years. We mentioned last year 99 wins, and the year before only played 144, won 100 of those. Great offensive ball club, and over the last 3-4 years, real good pitching to go with them.
Outstanding slider from Mussina there. It looks, as the guys in the dugout would say, nasty to me.
Well, he's got a no-hitter going and has no-hitter stuff. You know, his lowest hit game was a one-hitter back in 1992 against Texas. And with a 2-0 lead, you're not thinking no-hitter. You're thinking, let's get the first guy out, David Justice. As we mentioned earlier, it's a guy you know he's coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at least 3 or 4 times, hopefully only 3 times. Let's keep somebody off in front of him.
He's waiting. Mike Mussina is through the thick part of the Indians hitting lineup here with Williams, Justice, and Manny Ramirez, 4, 5, and 6. It's Jeff Newman, the acting manager tonight. Mike Hargrove, if you're just joining us, attending the graduation of his daughter back in the Cleveland area, high school graduation. So Newman, the acting manager, until tomorrow. Well, you're talking about two. There's Jeff Newman. That's been with Mike Hargrove and the Indians for quite some time. And of course, Buddy Bell, who we've seen a couple of times this year. Quality bench coach that was lost by the Indians because he gets the managerial seat with the Detroit Tigers before the 96 season.
And Toby Hara was there. He's no longer there. Johnny Gorel coming back.
Off speed just missed from Mike Mussina. 2-2 now on Matt Williams.
Second time through the lineup for Mike. Stuff is good enough where it really should make a difference if he's able to make the kind of quality pitches he's been making all game long. I mean, everything's been down, stayed out of the middle of the plate.
Cut on and miss. Mussina absolutely mesmerizing with that slider tonight as Williams chased it way out of the zone.
Well, sixth strikeout for Mike. Well, it was a knuckle curveball or the slider he's unveiled here in 1997, but great location, down and away. Two strikes, two balls. You got to protect the plate, even if you're a home run hitter. And Matt Williams once again having trouble identifying the pitch. Swings right over it.
Large advantage to you pitchers, Jim. I mean, if you felt guys couldn't identify, you probably felt you were about 99% ahead of the game.
Well, that is the difference between the Mussinas and the Clemens and, you know, the Maddoxes and the quality pitchers. I mean, the guys that win almost 70% of their starts, their stuff is that good. Great location, great movement. You know, the breaking ball is real sharp. Unpredictable, which is what he's been tonight. I mean, they don't know what's coming. And when he gets two strikes, they have to protect the plate, and they're not able to do it. They have to swing at all 17 inches plus the width of a baseball inside and outside. So the plate goes to about 22 inches, and they're unable to do it so far. But with a 2-0 lead, I mean, you walk somebody, tying run comes to the plate. The guy gets a base hit. So this is not a done deal yet.
David Justice at the plate. David is been on fire, as we saw firsthand last weekend in Cleveland in Jacobs Field against Oriole pitching. Coming over from the National League, Jim was talking about it. We were teasing David last weekend about the same thing. Well, where is your adjustment period? I mean, aren't you supposed to go around a time or two before you feel like you have a book on people in this league? Apparently not.
Well, you know, I was talking to one of the radio guys, Tom Hamilton, who you know, and he said David is pretty low-profile guy. But I'll tell you what, he would like to make a statement to Atlanta that you made a mistake.
Bouncing ball to the glove of Cal Ripken, wide at third. Two gone as Justice is thrown out.
I mean, he would like to put up some marquee numbers. I mean, they've already signed him to an extension all the way into, what, the 21st century. So John Hart, general manager, saying we want core players, and David Justice is going to be one of them. But when you get traded, especially from a quality team that wins and has had the best winning percentage in baseball in the 90s like Atlanta, you'll go, but you want your present missed. And it really has probably been off. Because he's off to such a great start, but Atlanta and the Orioles, two best records in baseball. The Orioles just a little bit better, playing almost 700 ball. And David saying Mussina is on a roll. He is.
Yep. Here's Manny Ramirez now. Manny looks at the called strike from Mike Mussina. Mike got his breaking pitch in. Manny, his first time, bounced out to Mike Bordick at short. 25th birthday for this young man. Jim was talking about what he's accomplished. Passed the mound to the glove of Robbie Alomar. 15 in a row. Retired by Mike Mussina. We on to something special here on this Friday night in the yard. 2-0 Birds on the O's TV network. Let's take a swing around our Helix Health baseball board. Oh, Boston's putting it to the New York Yankees in Old Back Bay. Mo Vaughn just left the yard. 9-0 Red Sox. Chicago-Milwaukee just getting underway. They're scoreless in the second. Ditto for Kansas City and Texas just getting beginning down in Arlington. Detroit and Seattle, game one of the doubleheader. No score in the first out in the Kingdom. National League, Cincinnati 5-1 over Chicago in the fifth. Colorado's jumped on Florida, leading 3-0 in the sixth in South Florida. Pittsburgh's Pirates got it up 5-2 over Montreal for Gene Lamont in the fifth. Atlanta's 2-0 over San Francisco down at Turner Field. Philly and the Mets. How about the Amazons playing very good baseball? 1-1 with Philly in the fourth. LA and St. Louis. Nothing happening. San Diego's got two on the board in the Astrodome in Houston. And you are up to date on our Helix Health baseball board. Here, we're in the bottom of the fifth at the yard. Glad to have you along on the O's TV network. 2-0 Orioles. Robbie Alomar's been one of the ringleaders of the O's offense tonight. Robbie 2-for-2. Had a bunt base hit his first time, an infield base hit his second time, scored once. Two and one on Alomar, who swinging the bat a lot better, Jim, from the left side. We saw Robbie just tattoo the facing of the third deck in Tiger Stadium the other night. But he's telling us that he's starting to feel better, getting more push off from the right side on that ankle.
Well, it appeared that way. Went out and got that ball on the outside part of the plate and just smoked it. But you can still see him limping when he runs bait. You know, when he has to slow up, start up, and when he goes and turns a double play. Difficult to push off that left ankle.
Lifted in the air, deep and down the line and left, but it's going to fade foul down by that 333 mark. And as we were talking last weekend, you know, Alomar comes to the plate, and in Jacobs Field, it's like, just look at him in disbelief because he absolutely crushed an entire city in October, the first Saturday of October last year, when he did the Indians in that epic game four.
Well, he tied it off of Mesa, yep. But in the ninth, and then homered in the 12th.
Driven deep to right, not going to stay fair. Hooking foul. Robbie made a bid to tack another one on.
Well, Charles Nagy saying, well, I don't want to walk Alomar to lead off the inning, but on the other hand, I don't want to give him another run either. I'm going to try to make a little better pitch here.
Popped him up in the short center field. Grissom with a long way to go. Marquise will put it away. Alomar retired on the fly ball. They're better pitch.
No, was it ever. Threw him a changeup down and away, and you saw the one-handed swing. I mean, there is a luck factor in this game because, you know, you get a ball in the middle of the plate and Robbie sees it so well, he just gets a little bit quick and hooks it foul.
As we said, we are online with you tonight at Keyword HTS and, of course, with Rafael Palmeiro at the plate. Rafael with one of the two RBI in the night. And a bounce it to the glove of Jim Tomey, who will handle it. One of our viewers, Jim, asking as Rafael bounces out, who would you pick to start at first base for the American League if you're doing the voting right now in the All-Star game? I'd have to go with the big hurt. Frank Thomas is just crushing the ball again in Chicago.
Yeah, and the guy that I'd also got to get some recognition is Tino Martinez,
sure,
with 20 home runs. I mean, everybody's talking about Griffey, who is ahead of on a schedule, maybe not a schedule, but on a pace. Mm-hmm. Maybe he is on a schedule. He thinks he's on a schedule to hit 73 home runs. But how about Tino Martinez with 20? I got to assume that he's close to being on the pace to maybe break or tie Maris's record.
Oh, no question about it. And you, when Seattle was in here about 3 weeks ago now, you talked to Junior a lot that weekend about some of the situations that he was, we could see then, he was going to start getting involved with regard to that.
Well, if anybody could handle it, I would think it's somebody that, I mean, really enjoys just being Junior. You know, obviously he's going to, you know, have to do what Cal did when he got close to breaking Garrett's record, which is to, you know, have a press conference on the first day maybe of every road trip they go when they go into a town. But I mean, you really have to control the media crush, which obviously would happen if he gets close to, you know, maybe 50 home runs going into September. And you can do that. I mean, John Maroon did a terrific job here.
Yeah, I remember that season well as Cal Ripken now ahead of Charlie Nagy at 3-1. Cal hitting with two out, nobody on here in the bottom of the fifth. Orioles with a 2-0 lead as Mussina and Nagy, two of the best right-handers in the American League, dueling it out. Charlie Nagy lost Cal Ripken, and that is, other than the free pass to B.J. Surhoff, the first base on balls that Nagy has issued this evening.
So you walk Cal Ripken, who came in hitting around maybe 260 off of Nagy, to get to a guy that wears you out and almost hit a home run, except that on the 3-0 pitch, hit it to straightaway center field. B.J. Lifetime hitting close to 400, in the high 380s.
Yeah, he's touched up Charlie Nagy for one home run and five RBI in near meetings. Went deep on him in the ALCS last year in Jacobs Field.
He's unable to get ahead in the count. B.J. can pretty much sit on a pitch, and he's prone to do that. I mean, if anybody should have success, it's a guy like B.J. Surhoff. I mean, a workaholic. Struggled early in the year, and you know, now is on a run. Got his batting average to 340. Staying on the ball. I mean, he's driving the ball left center, right center. Really back where he was last year, where he had a career year as far as home runs with 21, even though he was injured.
3-1 on B.J. So impressed with him the other day to Jim, as we were with the left-handed swingers, Anderson, Palmeiro, Surhoff, how they handled Andy Pettit, who I have a great deal of respect for, is one of the tops in the game. Eight base hits between the three of them against Pettit.
Mm-hmm. Got an idea of what Joe Torre thinks about that bullpen up there.
Oh yeah.
Pettit squandered a 6-2 lead.
Payoff pitch. Charles Nagy has just lost B.J. Surhoff. Now giving up back-to-back walks to Ripken and Surhoff with two out. Give Pete Incaviglia a chance here to maybe tack one on or so in the bottom of the fifth.
Well, how you get into the situation is pretty easy. You get behind Cal. You know you're down 2-0. You know Mussina with a no-hitter has been perfect, so you can't give up any more runs. So you walk Ripken, then the guy coming to the plate is hitting about 385 off you. You get behind him, you walk him,
sure,
and you hope you can pitch to Incaviglia like you did the first two times, which is two strikeouts. Made great pitches. And Mike Mussina is causing all of this because he is pitching so well. I mean, Charles Nagy, he's been around long enough to know he better not give up any more.
Mm-hmm. We're pleased to be joined by our feathered friend, the Bird. And the Bird, thanks for coming up to the booth. The Bird wants to make sure he says hi to his biggest fan, Vernon Calvert. So, Bird, you say hello to Vernon. And I know Vernon's checking you out tonight now here on Orioles Baseball. A kiss for Jim Palmer.
Oh, is that what that was? A peck.
A peck. Very good. Look out. Oh, Incaviglia got that in the wrist area of the left hand. And we'll take a check on Pete now as Richie Bansell's out right away to check on Incaviglia. Maybe wrist up to the elbow.
Yeah, I think I got him up on the elbow. And it might have gotten a nerve. You hope that's all it is. A lot of nerves coming down your arm into your hand. And I think you can see right above the elbow where the ball hit. Red little mark right there. Take another look. You see how far this ball just keeps running. Alomar sitting inside. It just runs and got him right on the top of the elbow.
Now, Incaviglia looks like he is going to be taken out of the contest to be attended to by Orioles trainer Richie Bansells. And David Johnson will get a pinch runner in, it's going to be Jeffrey Hammonds. So Hammonds will take over the DH role for Pete Incaviglia after he was drilled, as Jim said, in the point of that left elbow by Charlie Nagy. This fifth inning's going innocently enough. He retired Alomar and Palmeiro. And now he's got the bases loaded as he's issued walks to Ripken and Surhoff and hit Incaviglia.
Mark Wiley will come out in a little conference. I talked with Mark Wiley a couple of years ago about Charles Nagy, and he called him a long armor. In other words, actually kind of, you know, a lot of extension, and if the body gets out too early, what happens? The arm never catches up. So one again, I mean, Ray Miller not really into mechanics, but sometimes a pitching coach will just see that you're jumping out and maybe not staying back, some little thing. And of course, I talked to Mark Wiley, and he said, you know, one of the keys to being a good pitching coach is not only knowing what you're talking about, but also establishing trust. And you go out and try to go out there with a positive note, very much like Ray Miller does all the time, and try to be helpful. And Tony Tarasco try to put those two strikeouts in his back pocket and get a good pitch to hit and hit it. Chance to break open the game right
now. Yeah, he could be very helpful right now. Bases loaded with Orioles with two out here in the bottom of the fifth. 1-1 on Tarasco. Ripken, Surhoff, and Hammonds. Three Orioles. A lot of traffic on the base pass right now. Tarasco, as we said, he's had some key base hits for the Birds this year. Tony looking for one more right here. Lifted the breaking pitch in the air to short center field. Marquise Grissom will collar it, and that'll do it. Orioles strand three. We're going to the six. Still 2-0 Birds on the Orioles Television Network. All right, O's fans, you're looking for your best deal on a newer used car? You must go to Mr. Nobody's Town and Country Pontiac Nissan Suzuki. They're on Bel Air Road in Perry Hall. Now, if it's not a Town and Country deal for Mr. Nobody, it is absolutely not your best automobile deal. Go check them out. I didn't even see Jim Palmer hanging over there with his friend Mr. Nobody. You never know.
You never know. One thing we do know, as you look at the Indians, still looking for their first hits, as Tony Fernandez will lead it off in the sixth.
Pitch count, Jim, 43 strikes in the 64 he's thrown. So what, he's averaging in the vicinity
about 12,
of about 12,
yeah,
12
an inning.
Not
getting
bad.
Them all over.
Yep.
Well, it appears to me that they're almost looking for the knuckle curveball early in the count. Matt Williams last inning hit one just foul. The ball stayed fair. It might have been a double over the bag. But and right there, Fernandez, because if you're not looking for it, why are you swinging at it? Because you can't hit it.
Just like that, too. Mussina right out ahead of everybody tonight. 0-2 already with Tony Fernandez. Mike went seven innings, gave up nine hits and the three runs last Saturday in Jacobs Field to this Indian ball club, and got the win in the 8-3 decision.
Well, I honestly think he's been a much better pitcher this year than last year. Now 119 games, but the ERA almost five runs a game at 4.86 last year. But if you take away that first start after he missed opening day with the elbow problem in Texas, where he gave up seven runs, and then two other glitches, one in Seattle where against one of the better hitting ball clubs, leading the league in runs scored. I mean, his stuff is better. He's keeping the ball down. He's come up with a little bit of slider that against right-handed hitters makes him much more effective. Knuckle curveball has never been better. Control has been magnificent, you know, doing everything. You can't run on him. He's feeling his position, which is why he's 6-1. They've gotten him a lot of runs, with the exception of the night, averaging about 6.8 for his 11 starts.
Struck out Tony Fernandez his first time.
That paralyzed him on a knuckle curveball. Hmm. This game can be made a lot easier if you get a lot of offense. Doesn't mean you don't have to pitch well to win, but it takes a lot of pressure off a lot of people. The manager, the bullpen.
Just outside the bag and foul.
still 2-2 on Fernandez. Now, Tony was a regular shortstop in New York City with Jordan Steinbrenner's Yankees and was going to be the regular second baseman, Jim, last year until missed the entire season with the injury problem. They wind up turning it over to Mariano Duncan after Pat Kelly, and you know, then Fernandez is cut free and he winds up here in Cleveland.
Well, that's the amazing thing. If you look back at the Yankees, Tony Fernandez didn't play at all last year after he broke his elbow in spring training. But Duncan comes in and has a tremendous offensive year, but on a ball club that really was about doing the little thing is not a very good defensive second baseman. It seemed like when they came to Baltimore and they beat the Orioles 14 out of 18, if you include the American League Championship Series, he'd make an error, but then he'd get a two-run single to make up for it. But Fernandez, we'll see how he plays second base.
Made a throwing error tonight, and it's cost run number two that on the ball that Alomar hit, the infield base hit. Robbie eventually came around to score. 2-2 to Tony Fernandez.
Because the Indians, even though we talked about how potent their offense is, in April they were 12 wins, 13 losses, and their ERA was 6.8. And they averaged almost 7 runs a game. Now in May they're 15-9. The ERA is about 3.8, and they're scoring 6 runs a game. So much better team when they pitch well.
Battling are Tony Fernandez and Mike Mussina right now. Fernandez leading off to 6. Mussina, if you're just joining us, pitch perfect. Has retired 15 in a row. As the man known as the Moose in the Orioles clubhouse, guns for his 7th at the end of the year in this start number 11. In the air behind Mike Bordick at short, will drift out in that grass and put it away.
I'll tell you, you get through this inning and they get a couple more runs, you really start thinking no hitter. I mean, if you're Mike at this point right now with a 2-0 lead, you're saying, okay, I need 11 more outs. That's to win the game. But as you get deeper into the game and you look at the scoreboard, and I've been there, you start thinking, well, let's see, I got a chance to pitch a no hitter.
I don't even want to say anything right now.
we have nothing to do with it.
So you're obviously you're not superstitious.
No,
about
not
this
at all.
Stuff whatsoever.
I mean, the night I did it, I had Don Buford playing second base and Bobby Floyd playing short. Belanger and Gritch took the night off.
All of my friends in the truck on our wonderful Orioles television network crew, I mentioned it between innings last inning. They jumped all over me.
Did they?
They chastised me pretty good. Yeah, 15 in a row. No, 16. They all read me the riot act.
Okay, he's having a bad night. You're supposed to lie. I mean, the fans, you can hear right there, 0-2 pitch. They're already there with him.
Sandy Alomar was one of the 6 strikeout victims from Mike Mussina. First time he faced him.
Well, our colleague Mike Flanagan, I mean, I saw him go into the 9th with 2 outs. And Gary Alexander hit a home run down the right field line to break up his no hitter. Cuellar a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
Had a perfect game going into the 9th and Ken Suarez. Went 2-0 on him, didn't want to walk him because I'd already pitched a no hitter. Belanger moved over, he hit a grounder up the middle. Goodbye.
Called strike 3. Rung up is Sandy Alomar Jr. As he looked at 1 too many. That's number 7 on the strikeout side for Mike Mussina. 2 gone in the 6th.
About 4 of them on knuckle curveballs. Once again, can't pick up the spin. Great location. About thigh high outside part of the plate. overhead look maybe just a shade off the outside part of the plate, but we've already seen that Terry Kraft, you throw it there, he's going to give you a little bit outside.
Mussina dealing with Omar Vizquel here now to potentially end the sixth with two out and nobody on.
Look at Davey Nelson gave it to the young lady with the Cleveland Indian hat on.
Cutting his luck a little bit maybe against Mussina. 0-2 fastball. Vizquel took a look at it. 47,759. Ninth sellout of the year here at the yard. Fifth largest of the regular season as they're packed in to see the birds here tonight against the leaders in the AL Central, the Cleveland Indians. 0-2 pitch. Missed away. 1-2 on Vizquel. Jim, I think you're right. You're starting to feel a little bit of the emotion now. The noise level is starting to kick up a little bit here in the sixth. Mussina is just blowing people away. For Mike, his eighth strikeout of the night. Got two Indians in the sixth. Still 2-0 Orioles with Mussina in control. Tonight's contestant in the Pepsi Big Slam Home Run Derby inning is Rose Emery of Baltimore. Rose, a Baltimore player, hits any home runs during tonight's Pepsi Big Slam inning, and you're going to win a case of Pepsi and $100 to enter the Pepsi Big Slam Home Run Derby inning. Send a postcard to the address on the screen. Good luck, Rose. You've got Oriole hitters coming to the plate for you in the bottom of the sixth, and if they can dial up some long distance, you've got money coming to you. Chris Hoyles, Mike Bordick, and then back to the top for Brady Anderson. 2-0 Orioles. O's with five base hits. Indians have made an error that helped the Orioles capitalize and pick up their second run of the contest. We'll see if the offense does any damage here against Charles Nagy. Jim, I'm sure you've been on where Nagy is on the other side of these occasionally. You're pitching very well, and yet your ball club is just showing no signs of denting your opponent at all. Orioles to the hole. Look at this Vizquel layout. Straight and fire. Wild throw. It got by Tony. An infield base hit for Chris Hoyles, and he'll go to second base on the Omar Vizquel error. And that's something you're not going to see. You will see Vizquel lay out and make wonderful plays. Unusual to see him throw it away.
Well, he did not play at all till about the 26th, 27th of March because of this rotator cuff injury. You can see why he's won all those gold gloves, four in a row, but seems like he just dropped his arm. You do it on the mound, everything goes high, and as you do it at shortstop. But great, great quickness to get to this ball. You see how smooth he is and how deftly he can field the ball. Gets up quickly and then kind of throws a grenade over there, and Tomei, as tall as he is, can't come up with it. And let's see if Mike Bordick can get Chris Hoyles with less than two outs, as you see the result.
Bordick took a shot the other way and a high hop to the glove of Jim Tomei. Did his job inside out, went to the right side, advances Hoyles on the bounce out to the glove of Tomei.
It's the way the game is supposed to be played. You got a two-run lead, whether it's 2-0, 4-2, 6-4, you want to add on. This ball has to mock her up and he's throwing for the Indians. And once again, Cleveland will bring their infield in, trailing 2-0 here in the sixth. Try to cut off a run. Good hitting opportunity for Brady Anderson.
Nagy out of the set to Brady. Swung right through that Nagy breaking pitch under Brady's hands. Brady had a two-base hit, scored a run to get the Orioles off and moving offensively in the bottom of the first. 31 RBI now for Anderson as you take a look at Chris Hoyles. With his lead at third, hoping to tack on. Up the middle, base hit center field. Brady Anderson delivers the one out RBI base hit. Hoyles will touch in. 3-0 Birds. 32nd RBI of the year for Brady, hitting in a very advantageous situation.
Certainly was. You know, Nagy throws his glove down, kind of pounds it in disgust because he didn't make the pitch he wanted to, but You bring the infield in, you take a 335 hitter, you can make him close to 500. Gets a good pitch to hit, drives it back up the middle, which is what his intentions were. You can see Vizquel dive, and Hoyles will make it 3-0. And now you got Alomar up with Anderson, who can run. Brady's 7 out of 12.
There goes Brady. Alomar's throw, not in time. Brady Anderson with a stolen base for Brady on the year. That's number 8 leading the ball club in the stolen base category. He too now in scoring position for Roberto Alomar here in the Bird 6th.
Well, Nagy doesn't give up a lot of home runs, but you can run on him. 9 out of 12. Even though Alomar having a pretty good year throwing guys out about 34%.
Robbie will push it to Matt Williams. Bare hand. Got it. Oh, outstanding play from Matt Williams. Jim, we saw him do it twice last weekend. You mentioned gold glove. How about bare hand, one motion to ring up Alomar?
Well, I played with Brooks Robinson for a lot of years. He won 16 gold gloves. Matt's only garnered 3. You don't make it any better than this. Doesn't seem as good a play with Robbie with the runner in scoring position. If he doesn't be safe at first, but right here, Matt Williams, the difference. Very close at first. Take another look at Robbie headlong dive and the throw just by about 2 or 3 inches beats him. And Mark Wiley will come out to say, hey, who do you want to pitch to? Is it going to be Palmeiro or Ripken with 2 outs? Already down 3-0. This could be a huge run.
Twice in this contest, it happened in the 3rd, and now it's happened in the 6th. After infield base hits, throwing errors from the Indians' middle infield defense, Fernandez in the 3rd, and now Vizquel in the 6th have positioned the Orioles to be able to tack 2 on to bump this lead to 3-0.
And because Mussina's pitched so well, it's allowed Davey to play that type of baseball. I mean, this is what good pitching does. It puts pressure on the opposition. And if you got a guy that you know, if you're Jeff Newman subbing for the manager Mike Hargrove, and you know a guy that's got a 5-6 point ERA, you maybe don't play your infield back in certain situations early in the game. You get a Mussina on the mound, constant pressure. You can't give the opposition any more, and that applies right here. There's been pressure on Charles Nagy from the first inning when they walked the bases loaded, and he was able to get a couple of strikeouts to get out with only 1 run.
And the runners at the corners now at 2 down. Here's Cal. Ripken tonight officially 0-for-2. He'd have an RBI as he bounced into a fielder's choice and picked up the run batted in, plating Robbie Alomar back in the O's 3rd. He's got a chance here to deliver the clutch 2-out base hit. Popped him up. Going to get Nagy out of the 6th. Tony says, I'll handle it. Puts a squeeze on it, and that'll do it. O's add one more. We're 2/3 of the way home. Mike Mussina coming out for the 7th now with a 3-0 lead on the Orioles TV network. Let's swing around our Southwest Airlines game summary here as we go to the 7th. Brady Anderson's got a couple of base hits, double, single, scored 1, RBI, stolen 1. Pete Incaviglia had to leave the contest after he was hit by a Charlie Nagy pitch in the elbow. Mike Mussina, perfect game through 6, 8 strikeouts. you see what our crew has after the 8 Ks, Jim?
Yes, I do.
They are superstitious.
And so is Mike. He'd like to silence this lineup for 9 more outs. Doesn't seem like it's that difficult.
Oh, no. Not difficult at all. Nothing to it.
All you need is 9 more in a row.
Should be easily done. Marquise Grissom with a fly ball to right. Now 8 more.
That's right. Only 8.
Tony Tarasco put it away. 19 in a row for Mike Mussina. Are we sitting on the verge of something monumental happening at the yard here tonight for the O's ace right-hander? By the number on the board,
where the Indians offense is concerned, nothing but goose eggs everywhere. 0 for 2 is Julio Franco. That goes without saying. You know one thing, a lot of professional hitters that Mike Mussina is going to have to deal with in these final, Jim, as you mentioned, getting 8 more outs. He'll see Tomy and Williams and Justice and Ramirez and Franco and Alomar and Vizquel.
But the intriguing thing to me is that, first of all, he hadn't thrown too many hittable pitches, and they haven't hit a ball hard. Haven't been any great plays at this point. I mean, it's a visual medium. People sitting at home can see how terrific Mike Mussina's been tonight. I mean, no hanging knuckle curveballs, no changeups that have been up in the strike zone. Hadn't been behind the hitters very often.
O2 to Franco.
Like to be Jeff Newman, take over for Mike Hargrove, and your team gets no hit.
You know he's going to get a phone call tonight.
Could have been. You just got to get home plate umpire Terry Kraft into the mode.
Thought he's been somewhat generous.
Well, he has, but that's why I said that could have been.
2-2 pitch. Bouncing ball to the glove of Robbie Alomar on the outfield grass. Two down in the Indian seventh.
Down to seven.
I would suggest you buckle it on in and stay right here. Don't move.
I'm not going anywhere.
You don't want to miss a piece of something, as I said, that will be of the monumental magnitude here, potentially, from Mike Mussina.
We'll see. Tomei ran the count to 3-2, took a knuckle curveball for strike three, and then checked, swung on a changeup. And we'll see. Usually a very patient hitter if he tries to. What I've been seeing is that you don't want to get to two strikes. That's how good the stuff Mike Mussina has been, that he'll be a little more aggressive early in the strike zone here.
To the glove of Alomar. Mike Mussina now just 6 outs away. Another perfect inning against Indian hitting. Get on up and stretch it out, O's fans. 3-0 Birds on the Orioles Television Network. Let's take a peek at our Helix Health baseball board. New York Yankees coming back a little bit. Mo Vaughn with a home run tonight. Boston leading the Yanks 9-4 in the eighth. Chicago and Milwaukee scoreless. They're in the fifth in Milwaukee. Kansas City on top of Texas 3-1 in the third. National League, Cincinnati beat the Chicago Cubs tonight in Wrigley 5-1. Colorado 3-2 over Florida there in the eighth down to Miami. Pittsburgh on top of Montreal 8-2 in Three Rivers in the seventh. Frisco and Atlanta tied at 2 apiece down in the state of Georgia. And the Mets lead Philadelphia 4-2 at Shea in the seventh. St. Louis on top of L.A. 1-0 in the fifth. And that's a peek at your Helix Health baseball board. Ray Miller with one of his pupils sitting on the verge, potentially, of something extraordinary. We're going to the bottom of the seventh. 3-0 Orioles against Charlie Nagy. B.J. Surhoff, first pitch, line drive, base hit over the outstretched glove of Tony Fernandez. So for B.J. on the night, that is his first base hit. It's the third time that he's reached in four plate appearances.
Boy, is he locked in. I mean, he goes down and gets that off-speed pitch down and away and just pings it into right field. And Charles Nagy not pitching that badly. Should be trailing 1-0, but trails 3-0.
Jeffrey Hammonds, Jeffrey's first trip to the plate tonight. Hammonds took over when Pete Incaviglia, back in the fifth, was hit on the point of the left elbow by Charles Nagy fastball. So Hammonds becoming the DH.
Lifetime off Nagy, 5 for 12, 417 with a double. And as you mentioned, Davey Johnson saying, I'm going to try to platoon these guys. You know, Hammond's coming off that great game in New York with telling three run shot.
So, Jim, as we're saying, if you're Charles Nagy right now, as Paul Ostenmacher heats up, he ought to be feeling pretty helpless. I mean, he's scattered the eight base hits, giving up three. Two of the ones he's given up, direct results of errors behind him, and yet it's almost like tonight's not going to be a goal for me.
I don't know. I had about 580 starts, and when your team doesn't score a lot of runs and you give up one, two, or three, I mean, well, even the good games sometimes it would feel very frustrating, but I think if you're a pragmatist, you get in touch with that. If you pitch this well against most pitchers, and Mike Mussina isn't most pitchers, with their ball club, he's going to win a lot of games, and that's how he wins 16 to 17 every year. You know, his earned run average, as we mentioned, third best in the American League last year, and still under four runs a game. That's going to put a lot of wins in the column if you can do that 35, 37 times a year.
3-1 on Jeffrey as he looked at the Nagy fastball for a called strike. Orioles with a 3-0 advantage and with a chance here after the B.J. Surhoff base hit to maybe tack some more on in the seventh. A big gap in the right center field for Jeffrey. I mean, Marquise Grissom, as you see there, about 8 yards to the left hand side of second base, playing Jeffrey to pull, and there's a huge gap between him and Ramirez. In the air to short left off the bat of Hammonds. Justice broke back, but now he'll come toward the diamond to put it away. That Hammonds big swing had David Justice breaking back a step.
We call that a drop step. That ball hit so highly. David, who in Atlanta played right field, says the ball comes off the bat a little bit differently, but he's made the adjustment. And then Manny Ramirez has one of those right field arms, as we mentioned, 19 assists last year, so that's his better position.
Tony Tarasco now with an opportunity against Charles Nagy. Tony's 0 for 3 tonight. Struck out a couple of times and fly to center.
Had a great curveball to hit last time, but just popped it up to short center field. Nagy got a curveball up in the strike zone, but Tony's swinging under it.
Just out in front of the plate. Alomar is going to go to second. Not in time. Not in time at first. Sandy Alomar couldn't get B.J. Surhoff. Vizquel not able to get the speedy Tony Tarasco.
Well, just the little things. If you're B.J. Surhoff, when you came up, number one draft choice, you were probably one of the best, if not the fastest, catcher in baseball. Now he's a left fielder. He gets a good jump off of first. So right here, Alomar, I mean, he's optimist. He's going to say, hey, plays in front of me. Surhoff doesn't run that well, but he gets a good jump, and then Tarasco running hard, and that's the key. Otherwise, Vizquel, he senses he's not going to get the out. He comes off quickly at shortstop and tries to get the out at first. Unable to do it because Tony Tarasco runs the ball out.
Tarasco safe on the fielder's choice. Base hit there for Tony. There's Chris Hoyles now. Two on and one out. In the seventh, the O's with 8 base hits, but they have left 10 on tonight. And battling Charles Nagy, the ace of the Indian staff. Hoyles has one of the 8 Oriole base hits. Take a look at the breaking pitch for a called strike. 1-1 on Hoyles. Orioles trying to even up this series with the Indians so far this year, and game number 4 between the two clubs. Driven to deep right center field. Grissom on the go to the track. Marquise is going to get there. Surhoff's going to tag and cruise into third. Tarasco will stay put at first. Grissom had a long way to go. He's playing Hoyles to pull, showing you the ground he can cover.
Well, that's why they gave him the gold glove the last 4 years in the National League, and that's why they made the trade. Knew they couldn't sign Kenny Lofton. He resisted signing any kind of long-term contract. He was talking $9-10 million. So you get a guy out that's got a couple years on his contract, you give him an extension. He's not hitting like they would, but Hoyles, as you mentioned, drives this ball, hanging curveball up the gap, and Grissom, as he did in Atlanta for years, just runs it down. DJ tags up and runners at first and third with two outs.
See if Mike Borda can deliver the key two-out base hit for the O's. Mike's 1-for-3. And a base hit to center back in the fourth, up to 210 now. That's his high water mark of the year.
I mean, Marquise Grissom plays as shallow as any center fielder in baseball. I mean, you're not going to play Mike Bordick that deep anyway because he's primarily a line drive hitter. But he is playing shallow. And, you know, that tells me that he can go back on the ball. I mean, Paul Blair played as shallow as anybody, and nobody ever went back on a baseball as quickly. Just had one of those innate senses to know where the fence is. Also had the great vertical leap. He didn't have that Freddie Lynn, kind of that torpedo launch into the fence. Paul can run right to the fence and go up. SMU was bothered and on the disabled list with a hamstring pull. Says he's all right.
Turn Bordick loose 3-0. Matt Williams is going to throw him out. Orioles strand two more. They've stranded 12 on the night. Can Mike Mussina continue to stay perfect? You need to come on back and find out in the eighth. 3-0 Orioles. Nothing like Mike Mussina perfection through seven. 21 in a row retired as Matt Williams leads off the top of the eighth. He's got the wave through Williams, Justice, and Ramirez. 4, 5, and 6 here in the eighth.
With only a 3-run lead. You know, you talk about that zone you get in where it just feels like you and the catcher. I mean, there's just this little tunnel. Whatever you throw, well, that's what he's been in the first 7 innings.
Popped him up. A lot of room for Palmeiro. 5 to go. They're starting to anticipate here at the yard. All right, a few innings ago, we asked you, who was the last Indian to lead the club in home runs for the Cleveland organization other than Albert Bell? Jim, I'm going to take a guess and say Andre Thornton back in the late 80s, and I don't know. Just a guess. Wrong.
That's right.
Candy Maldonado.
And they didn't re-sign him.
They did not.
He's making too much money. Making $850,000 a year.
That was too much.
That's the minimum now, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the neighborhood. Here's David Justice. Driven in the air to left center field. Anderson says, I will, and puts it away. Two down in the eighth. 4 outs to go for Mike Mussina.
Well, there's your first hittable pitch in a long, long time. And Justice could not stay back on the changeup, and Brady runs it down. Just has not been any balls hit hard and any pitches that you could hit hard until that one.
$47,759. Ninth sellout of the year here at the yard. Are they all looking in on a piece of baseball history? Here's Manny Ramirez. Ramirez has grounded out twice tonight against Mussina, to Bordick and to Robbie Alomar. There has never been perfection on the pitching mound in Baltimore Oriole history. 5 no hitters. The man to my right, my partner Jim Palmer, threw one of them. Our other colleague, Mike Flanagan, involved in one of them.
And what do you do here? 2-0, you got a perfect game. I mean, if you'd already, you know, somebody had made an error, you walk somebody, you say, well, maybe I'll pitch around him, take a chance with a 3-run lead. But we'll see what Mike does.
Came right at him.
Well, it's one of those nights. You got your best stuff, you got your concentration, everything is going.
in the air for the glove of Tony Tarasco. 24 in the book. Three to go for Mike Mussina. Hang in. Bottom of the eighth coming up at the yard. 3-0 Birds on the Orioles Television Network. Those fans, everything you ever want to know about your favorite baseball team is on the Orioles official internet website provided by Bell Atlantic Internet Solutions for O stats, history, ticket info, and a whole lot more. Visit today at www.theorioles.com. History. Underline that because we may be sitting on it in the yard on this Friday evening as Paul Aschenmacher takes over on the mound for Charles Nagy. Aschenmacher, one of the guys that have been strong for the last few years out of Mike Hargrove's bullpen.
But struggling this year, normally, you know, just a lock. You bring him in, you sequence him in against left-handers, and he does an outstanding job this year. They're hitting about 360. He's given up 5 home runs, 3 by left-handers. So the bullpen a little bit in turmoil, but Jose Mesa back. Mike Jackson coming on to be the closer, and Aschenmacher before the year's over, no doubt, will be as effective as he normally is against lefties, and that's his role.
It'll be Brady Anderson, Roberto Alomar, and Rafael Palmeiro at the top of Davey Johnson's hitting lineup. Anderson, Alomar, and Palmeiro put together 5 of the 8 base hits, and they have been instrumental in providing Mike Mussina with his 3-0 lead as we go to the bottom of the 8th. Brady had an RBI base hit his last time, doubled and scored in the first. Breaking pitch shot to the glove of Matt Williams. The Gold Glover will handle Anderson and throw him out.
Second baseman.
Jim, suffice to say, everyone is certainly holding their collective breath now and can't wait to get to the top of the ninth.
I don't see anybody leaving.
Robbie's had a big night. Robbie 2-for-4, scored once. Both his base hits have been infield variety. Bunt base hit in the first, and then had the infield base hit that Tony Fernandez compounded by picking up the throwing error to allow Alomar to eventually come around and score. Base hit up the middle. Robbie Alomar 3-for-5 on the night as Roberto continues to swing the bat extremely well. Now above 280 as the average starts on its climb back toward 300.
Still trying to get well. Of course, trying to get well from the right side of the plate. Came in hitting 204. So, as you mentioned, the average totally will go up, but also from the right side. And, you know, that's it. That's his weakest side over the years. And last year, he had a terrific year from the right side, which is why he had such a great season.
There's Rafael. Palmeiro drove in the first run of the contest with his RBI base hit in the first. He had played at Brady Anderson, and right to this speaking, that's all that Mike Mussina has needed. O's have tacked 2 more on to build a 3-0 lead. And if you're just joining us, I'll mention it to you one time. Mike Mussina has retired 24 consecutive Indian hitters. He's 3 outs away from a perfect game. Aschenmacher checking on Alomar and dealing to Palmeiro, and misses away. 1-1 on the Birds first baseman. Jimmy, through your own no-hitter, you've been in the ballpark. We said no perfection in an Oriole uniform on the pitching side. You've been in the ballpark for one?
For a no-hitter?
For a perfect game. I know you threw a no-hitter. Have you been in the ballpark for a perfect game?
Nope. I vaguely remember Don Larson's. Didn't see Dennis Martinez's.
And was not that the El Presidente's? Wasn't that the last one?
I think it was.
Alomar on the go. Sandy Alomar's throw. He just gunned down his brother. So Palmeiro, the strikeout victim, and then Sandy Alomar guns down brother Robbie 2-4 to end the bottom of the eighth.
Double play, Alomar, who unable to throw out Brady Anderson early. Perfect throw, great tag right on the helmet by Omar Vizquel. And we'll be back with Mike Mussina in the top of the ninth right after this.
O's fans want to be a part of the Interleague Play Series here at the Yard, June 16, 17, and 18. That's when the Montreal Expos come in. You can get your tickets at the O's ticket office or the numbers you see on your screen. Orioles baseball, nothing like it day at the Yard. Buckle up now. Mike Mussina, with 24 in a row retired of Indian hitters tonight, starting the ninth. We want to welcome those of you joining us via ESPN News around the country. I'm Michael Regai. Hall of Famer Jim Palmer is here too, as we see if Mussina can become perfect here in the top of the ninth in Camden Yards. 1-1 on Tony Fernandez. 24 in a row has Mike Mussina set down of Indian hitting tonight.
And I believe only one 3-2 count, and that was to Jim Thome back in the first inning. Struck him out with 3-2 knuckle curveball. There is a portion of the fandom here at Camden Yard on their feet. And how often do you get to see somebody go into the ninth inning with a perfect game?
2-1 to Fernandez. Misses up. 3-1. The perfect game on the line on this pitch, as is the no-hitter on every pitch.
And then that's the point. You have a 3-0 lead. You don't want to walk anybody. But on the other hand, you know, Mussina all night has been able to make a perfect pitch.
Sharply to the glove of Robbie Alomar. One down in the ninth. Two to go for Mike Mussina.
Well, the next two hitters have been up four times. Sandy Alomar has struck out twice, and Vizquel has lined out and struck out.
Catch your breath. All rights to this baseball telecast are reserved. Any rebroadcast, recording, retransmission, or other use of the pictures without the express written permission of the Baltimore Orioles and CBS Cable is solely prohibited. Sandy Alomar with Mike Mussina here with one out in the ninth. And Brian Giles has grabbed the bat and is in the on-deck circle for acting manager Jeff Newman. He will swing for Omar Vizquel. But first, it's Sandy Alomar Jr. been punched out both times tonight by Mussina. He has struck out 8 on the evening and retired 25 Indian hitters in a row.
May be the best pitch he gets to hit. That fastball right down the middle. No strikeouts coming on knuckle curveballs.
Line to left, base hit. The villain in Baltimore, Maryland on this 30th of May is Sandy Alomar Jr. After 25 consecutive hitters retired by Mike Mussina, Sandy Alomar breaks up the perfect game and the no-hit bid with a ringing base hit to left.
And Rafael Palmeiro comes over to say something to Mike Mussina. I mean, when you have that kind of focus, that kind of concentration, this could disturb you, and immediately Davey Johnson will get somebody up in the bullpen. And it'll bring to the... Take another look right here. They try to go up and in on Alomar. And right there, Mike knows that that ball is going to be a base hit down the left field line.
Jim, what's your feeling? You get so close. You've been out there for 2.5 hours throwing 100 pitches. You're so close. How demoralizing is it?
Well, I don't think when you are the type of person that Mike Mussina is that it's demoralizing. I mean, you're focused. I mean, I can't even begin to describe how, I mean, your nerve endings are, you know, I mean, it feels like they're just part of your skin. But right now, the task at hand, and this is a very focused young man, is to get Giles out. And Giles 2-for-5 with a home run off Mike last year. You mentioned before the game, thought he might have a chance to play tonight. Might have been the DH. Of course, Franco having such an outstanding year. So right away, and Davey Johnson talked about with Kamenecki the other night. Good ball game against the Tigers when he gave up the first run. He should have gotten somebody up.
1-2 on Brian Giles, the compact left-handed swinging outfielder DH.
The reason that Mike Mussina has his success is because his ability to concentrate and focus. I mean, other than the natural ability. So I don't think this is going to bother him.
Jim Palmer, you threw your no-hitter on the 13th of August back in 1969. Any close calls earlier in the game where you were helped by strong defensive plays, or were you pretty much the way Mussina's
not really, but the difference was I got 8 runs, walked 9 guys, and got to pitch around who I want to get to in the ninth inning. The other times, I mean, I had a perfect game going in the ninth and hadn't walked anybody and went behind 2-0.
Cut on and miss. Strikeout number 9 of the night as Mussina rings up Brian Giles. 2 down now, going back to the top for leadoff hitter Marquise Grissom.
But the people that have had a chance to see this on TV and here at Camden Yards, you can't fail to understand how overpowering Mike Mussina has been against one of the finest hitting ball clubs in the American League. He didn't give him a chance tonight to this point.
And a fine hitting ball club that's been on fire swinging the bats in the last 10 games. There's Grissom.
I mean, he has stifled it. And you face 27, 28 batters and maybe give them 2 or 3 hittable balls, you have done one heck of a job.
One and one on Marquise Grissom. 47,759 on their feet, and they had their breath taken away with one out in the ninth after Mike Mussina had retired 25 Indians in a row, and Sandy Alomar broke up the perfect game in the no-hitter with a base hit to left. Mussina has remained focused as he went out and got Brian Giles, and now working on center fielder Marquise Grissom. One pitch. There goes Alomar. Fouled right side. Mussina one pitch away from capping off a brilliant performance.
Well, if he can get Grissom out, he will be the 32nd pitcher to pitch a one hitter for the Orioles.
So close to baseball immortality, Mike Mussina wraps up a stunning one-hit performance in shutting out the Cleveland Indians. Cleveland 3-0 the final.